with pranams at the lotus feet of Bhagavan. Dear brothers and sisters, first let me wish you a happy new year. This is the first meeting in this new year, 2003. I have few details to share with you that had happened in the month of December. Details I'll let you know. But three major aspects have been covered in this month, December. One aspect is Christmas and Jesus Christ. I'm sure you'll be very much interested in that. Number two, the visit of the President of India, Abdul Kalam, to this place, the sentiments he expressed, the opinion he had, the letter he wrote, that is the second aspect. And third aspect is the recent achievement of the Sri Sathya Sai University, and which has been declared as the best university in this country. That had happened recently. I would like to share these three points that had happened during the month of December. This is the conversation with Bhagavan that took place on 22nd December 2002. As you know, we are sharing the highlights of the divine dialogues. I don't say divine whispers, the divine dialogue. Our idea is, just as Ramana Maharishi's conversations are recorded, just as Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa conversations with the disciples are recorded and made available to all of us today, Bhagavan Sri Sasaiba's conversations should also be available for the posterity. We are all accountable. It is for this reason we have started this. I am glad that it is widely well received. The discussion on Christmas and Jesus Christ. It so happened the entire Prashant Nilayam, particularly afternoon time and evening till bhajan time, the campus is full of resonance and the Jesus Christ. It so happened the entire Prashant Nilayam, particularly afternoon time and evening till bhajan time, the campus is full of resonance and the resound of Christmas carols. Singing. Just before bhajan time, they stop and come to mandir. So wonderful, I tell you. Certain afternoons also I happen to hear, sitting with Bhagavan there, behind the curtain, in the Purnachandra auditorium. We were immensely happy. Bhagavan is immensely happy with the intensity of the devotion of these foreigners coming from different places, practicing carols meticulously, scrupulously, scientifically, carefully, to the dot of time. That's really fantastic. And Swami was in all appreciation for these foreigners. Both the preparation and the presentation as well. Let me also congratulate you on this account. 22nd of December, some of the conversation went on centering around Christmas and the life of Jesus Christ. Bhagavan said, the Catholics had their own philosophy. Catholics followed Christianity as per their own concept, but they were not accepted. A section of Christians opposed them, protested them, and hence they are called Protestants, That's what Bhagavan said. And in fact, Bhagavan also said that Jesus mentioned that every man is God. It means the Atma, the Self, or the Spirit is God. And this Swami calls it Chaitanya Shakti. Chaitanya Shakti. C-H-A-I-T-A-N-Y-A. Divine power, the divine energy, the cosmic energy is divinity. That's what Bhagavan explained. And Swami said how Jesus faced opposition. Many people questioned him. Many people doubted him. He faced all kinds of challenges like any God-man. Jesus said that all are God, all are equal, all are divine, while mentioning, while declaring his own divinity. Just as we find Bhagavan today, then a person asked him, Swami, are you God? He said, I am God and you are also God. And you are also God. This is what is there in the Jesus teaching. When he said that he is God and that all are equal, it meant the entire creation is divine. And then Bhagavan also mentioned a miracle that had happened during the life of Jesus Christ. It seems few fishermen, while were trying to fish, they have spread their net, but till the evening they could not catch a single fish. They were all very much disappointed and frustrated. It so happened, Jesus happened to pass by the same lane. He took them all to another point of the river and asked them, you try here. When they have spread the net there, they could catch lots and lots of fish to their astonishment and surprise. And they could know the glory of Jesus by this experience, what we call miracle. And Bhagavan said, a tax collector by name Matthew of the revenue department, he came there to collect tax from these fishermen. And the fishermen refused to pay the tax. But Jesus said, No. You got the fish now. Why do you speak lies? Earlier, you couldn't get it. But you could get so many fish now at the place I have shown to you. Why do you say that you don't have fish? You must pay the tax. That's what Jesus said. Jesus is justice. Jesus is truth. Jesus is righteousness. Jesus is law unto himself. There's no question, there's no doubt about this aspect of the divinity of Jesus Christ. Finding the truth of Jesus, Matthew got himself transformed totally and became his devotee and did not collect tax from the fishermen that day. He was simply moved. He was touched by the truth of Jesus Christ. And there is also another man, a great personality of biblical times, Paul, who questioned Jesus Christ, who doubted Jesus Christ, but having had Jesus appearing in the dream, Paul got himself transformed. He was the beneficiary of the teachings of Jesus Christ, and the Paul at one time a critic became Saint Paul later. Saint Paul later. This is what happens every time. Even today in the times of Bhagwan Sri Satya Sai Baba, critics get themselves transformed to their surprise. They just, most of the people who doubt him later become staunch devotees. This is how it happens. That's what had happened even in the times of Jesus. And then Bhagwan went on to say, when Jesus was born, three wise men happened to visit that place. One gentleman said, this child is going to love God. Another Arabian king said, the wise man, no, God is going to love this child. And finally, third wise man said, no, he is going to find his identity with God, that he is going to be God. That's what he said. That has been the imagination, the heights of devotion of the Arabian kings who happened to visit the newborn babe in Bethlehem on Christmas Day. And then Bhagavan mentioned another point. Jesus always was surrounded by his disciples, so many followers to hear his divine teachings. However, there was one disciple, Judas Iscariot. The Judas is a betrayer who cheated his guru, Jesus Christ, just for a pittance, just for money offered to him by the soldiers. He just cheated his guru, and that led to the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. By receiving few silver coins, Judas Iscariot told those soldiers, whosoever ring I kiss is Jesus. You can catch him. That's what he said. Because in those days, disciples and Jesus wore the same dress. It is difficult to identify. So Judas said, when I kiss the ring, you can identify that he is Jesus Christ. That's how he betrayed his guru. That's what Bhagwan has said. But what happened to other disciples? They also escaped on some pretext or other. Mary was crying, watching the situation of Jesus Christ, the only Son of God. And to crying mother Mary, Jesus said, mother, why do you cry? Death is the dress of life. Death is the dress of life. Commenting on this statement, Bhagavan said, one does not have to cry or worry about death. Just as we go on changing our dress time to time every day, do we cry? Certainly not. We wear new dress. Likewise, we put on the new body. There is neither birth nor death. It is something like changing dress. That's what Jesus mentioned. Death is the dress of life. Bhagavan mentioned the other statement of Jesus Christ. When there were so many people around, helpless, there are some people who are ready to blame him, ready to crucify him. Jesus, the only Son of God, the compassionate one, the righteous one, what did he say? All are one, my dear son, be alike to everyone. All are one, my dear son, be alike to everyone. What a statement it is. It is possible only for Christ to say that. Enemies on one hand, betrayer on the other side, disciples on one hand, pain and agony. With all this, the Son of God could say, all are one, my dear son, be alike to everyone. That's what Bhagavan said at one time. I think you remember. People may praise me, people may blame me, but I bless both of them. Because I am beyond. God transcends blame and praise. He is not carried away by your praise, nor depressed by the blame either. That's what Bhagavan has said. I have put this question, Bhagavan, I find the statue of Mary carrying infant Christ. People worship Mary also. Yes? In convents, we find Mary's statue. And we also find Mary holding Jesus on her lap. There's a very big church in Bangalore, Infant Jesus. Well, what is all about? Why people worship Mary? Bhagavan said, please note this point. Just as you people worship the mother of this body, he meant Ishwarama, for having given birth to this avatar, people also worship Mary in reverence, in adoration, in gratitude to that mother who gave birth to the Son of God. It's an act of gratitude. That's how Mary has come to be worshipped by Christians. That's what Bhagavan said. I have put another question. Swami, there are sages whom you call rishis in Sanatana Dharma. There are no sages in Bible. There are no sages in Christianity. I want you to comment upon this. Baba said, no. What you call a sage in Sanatana Dharma is a saint in the Holy Bible. Saint Paul, Saint Luke, Saint Matthew, Saint John, they are all sages. That's what Bhagavan mentioned. Then I put another question. Swami, I am proud to say that I am from a Christian college. I spent about 30 years in a Christian college. Even this day I am proud of my Christian college, my alma mater. If I could speak to you this much of English, the credit goes to the Christian missionaries, particularly Lutheran Church in America, that has sponsored our college, Andhra Christian College at Guntur. I am very proud of it even now. So I said this, Swami, because of my affinity, close intimacy with Christian theology, I have one question to ask. Swami was in a good mood to hear an answer. Come on, what do you say? Swami, how am I to understand when Christians, while praying, they say, Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. How am I to understand as a follower of Sanatana Dharma? What did Baba say? Did you not hear what I say quite often? You are not one but three. The one you think you are. The one others think you are. The one you really are, Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. Among the same, that's what Bhagavan has said. Swami, Jesus was crucified on the cross. What a pitiable situation is. I heard that you have shown the cross to a devotee by name John Hislop. Is that true? Yes, I have shown him the original cross on which Jesus was crucified to Hislop. Then I said, Swami, if you don't mind, if you are kind enough, let me know how Hislop came to your fold. How Hislop has come to know you. I want to know from him. Bhagavan said, Dr. Hislop stayed in Kashmir, the crown of India, with Himalayan ranges, about which you must have heard. Kislev stayed there in Kashmir for 10 years in search of sages and saints. He could not find them anywhere. But at that time there was one defense secretary of government of India whom he knew, Dr. Hislop, well. On his invitation, Hislop happened to visit Delhi, where at that moment Bhagwan happened to be there. And Hislop met Bhagwan for the first time there in Delhi. He met Swami not only in public, but also he went to the palace where Bhagwan stayed. And he saw Swami and is quite happy that he could see a sage or a saint whom he has been searching for all these ten years. And Hislop himself declared that he found a wide aura round the head of Bhagwan, as we notice in the case of noble souls. And Hislop expressed, after meeting Bhagwan, Sri Sat Sai Baba, that he has come to an end of his quest or his eternal search. And then Hislop followed Bhagwan wherever he went. Swami himself mentioned a miracle that had happened, that was experienced by Dr. John Hislop. Swami, it seems, asked Hislop to carry a big box, big trunk, iron trunk, full of saris, to carry that to a place where Bhagwan started distributing saris to everyone. Hislop was giving saris to Bhagwan and Bhagwan was distributing everybody there. As you know, Bhagwan always distributes best stuff, never second rate, big saris, everything mega size. However, there were few small saris which he did not distribute. When Hislop returned, he saw at the bottom of the trunk water, which was not there earlier. Had water been there in the beginning, the clothes would have been wet. It was not like that. He was very much surprised. Swami, what is this water? Bhagwan said, saris that were left, saris which were not fortunate enough to have been distributed to people by the divine hands, were crying for their ill fate, that they are miserable, that they didn't deserve that fortune to get into the hands of the divine himself. That's what Bhagwan mentioned that evening. That prompted me to put a question. Saris cry, Swami? How am I to believe it? Do saris have chaitanya or awareness? Chaitanya, chaitanya. Chaitanya or awareness, do they have it? Bhagwan said, in this world there is only awareness, that's all. There is no object without this awareness or chaitanya. Remember that. But chaitanya, awareness, expresses itself at three levels. At the body level, it is conscious. At the level of the mind, it is conscience. At the level of Atma, the spirit or the soul, it is consciousness. So, conscious, conscience, consciousness are the three levels of expression of awareness or chaitanya. In other words, in expression or the manifestation, there may be a degree of difference, but basically it is all awareness, what Bhagwan has said. Then I said, Swami, if everything is awareness, if everything is divine? Am I to understand now that I cannot misuse the five elements? That I cannot misuse my senses? I cannot abuse nature? Am I to understand like that? Bhagavan said, yes. That's why I tell you, do not waste. Haste makes waste. Waste makes worry. Do not be in a hurry. Don't waste food. Don't waste water. Don't waste energy. Don't waste money. Waste of money is evil. Life waste is time waste is life waste. Time waste is life waste. That Bhagavan said. In order to know, in order to inform every one of us that everything is essentially divine, that we cannot neglect, that we cannot be negligent, that we cannot underestimate at any cost. Then I said, Swami, thank you. You told us many, many things this evening. Many, many things. Bhagavan got up from his chair, walked a few steps and turned back. What things did I say? Swami, things that we do not know, things that we have wrongly understood, misunderstood, things that have brought light into our lives. We are very indeed grateful to you, Bhagavan. Thank you. That's what I said. Finally, I also said, Swami, how beautifully you have integrated Christian theology with Sanatana Dharma. So beautifully. What a beautiful synthesis it is. We have to learn from you only, Swami. We have to learn from you. Bhagavan said, turned back and said, I thought that he is proceeding towards the mandir. As all of you know, his is the final word. He will not leave you with your word as the final. He turned back and said, learning? No, you no use in learning. You should start experiencing, not learning. That's what Bhagavan has said. And Swami straight away said, before saying bye to everybody, because it's just bhajan time, the music started, it's time for him to go, and then he said, remember these two things, statements of Jesus. What are they? All are one, my dear son, be alike to everyone. What is the second statement? Death is the dress of life. Bye, he said. Then I would like to mention to you certain things Swami said on the 27th of December. This relates to the experiences of and the statements made by Dr. Kalam, the President of India, the first citizen and a great devotee of Bhagavan. Bhagavan told everybody on 27th December 2002, look here, tomorrow Abdul Kalam is going to speak there in Delhi on Sri Satya Sai University. He is going to speak on the PhD program of our university. Then he immediately called, Vice Chancellor, come on, he said. Immediately Vice Chancellor came and said, what news you received from Delhi? Then Vice Chancellor said, Swami, tomorrow the President is scheduled to speak at 11:30 a.m. in Vijnana Bhavan on the occasion of the Golden Jubilee of University Grants Commission, Government of India, and is going to speak on Sri Satya Sai University, the special reference to the PhD program. I see. What are the highlights in our PhD program? That's what Swami asked innocently. Maybe for us to know, Vice Chancellor said, fluoride and spectroscopy. Oh, I see. Okay, let them do whatever they like. And then Vice Chancellor mentioned Bhagavan among all the universities. The President of India liked the atmosphere of Sri Satya Sai University very much. Then Swami started joining. Swami also said the feelings and the sentiments expressed by Abdul Kalam. Yes, Kalam liked this atmosphere. He liked Swami and everything around. Yesterday, the Prime Minister, Deputy Prime Minister, the leader of the ruling party, Delhi Governor and Kalam, all of them sat together and spoke on Sai University only for 1.5 hours. And you know what they said? They all said that ours is a high-tech college. And Vajpayee, the Prime Minister of this country, said the Satya Sai University is so great because there is ideal master Bhagwan Sri Satya Sai Baba there. And Swami said, "Are boys, you know who is the ideal master?" They all said, "Swami, you are the ideal master." Then Bhagwan added, "Look here, Vajpayee, the Prime Minister, told Kalam, the President of India, look here, President, I know Bhagwan Sri Satya Sai Baba for the last 20 years. You have come to know for the last 1 or 2 years. I know his divinity and the university." And one teacher said, "Swami, I heard that Kalam, the President of India, said, Sai Baba ko Abdul Kalam ka salam." This is a sentence in Hindi, meaning salutations to Sai Baba from Abdul Kalam. Salam, salutation. Salam to Kalam. Swami said, "Yes, yes, that's what he said. He's a good devotee. Yes, you must have seen him also." That's what Bhagwan has said. Boys said, "Swami, we want you to see our sports preparation. Why don't you come to the stadium?" Bhagwan said, "I am not going to come. I am going to see on the final day." "Well, you want me to come, how can I come there? You are all doing motorbicycle stunts." "I never rided on motorbicycle." "Of course, I sat on the motorcycle, second seat. But I never had any ride on a motorbicycle. I sat behind." "Oh, Swami, did you?" "Yes. In those days, I had to come from Karnataka, Nagepalli. When I visited, when that village is completely in water, submerged because of rains, I had to take a circle, roundabout way, sitting behind another man who rided on his bicycle. But I don't know anything." Then he said, "Hey boys, I know car driving also. You know that? I have driven all the cars excepting BMW. That's what one said. December 29th, 2002, Swami made this statement. When the President came to Parthi, Kalam came to Parthi, he visited the super speciality hospital. He was very much inspired. he went back and spoke about a hospital in a conference. And the government of India is highly pleased with the work carried on here and has given 50 lakhs tax exemption for procuring equipment from foreign countries. That's what Bhagwan has said. And it seems Bhagwan spoke to few doctors that day, and he was asking, do you know who he is? Pointing out to some doctor, and they said, yes Swami, so and so. These are Swami's comments. Our life is a big hospital. Every particle has a name and form in this body, which is outward. Outward is pravritti. P-R-A-V-R-I-T-H-I. Pravritti. Outward. All our sense, every particle of the body is outward pravritti. Forgetting the innate inward nature. The true nature is inward, nivritti. N-I-V-R-I-T-H-I. The real nature is nivritti. Inward nature. That is our true identity. So, a scientist is the one who goes by pravritti, duly assisted by the government. He conducts number of experiments, taking the help of facilities given to him in a positive direction. But if the scientist is not encouraged, he turns negative. He chooses a wrong path altogether. That's what Bhagwan said. I have also few points to let you know. There is 24th December, just one dialogue, one sentence which is highly valuable. I made a statement, Swami, such an achievement of one state, made a statement that is going to do a lots of things for the state. Swami said, okay, is that so? Then I said, Swami, here is another chief minister who said that he is going to do so many things. And finally said, I don't say. Whatever I don't say. I don't declare. I do, that's all. There is no declaration. There is no announcement in respect of my activities and projects. That's what Bhagwan said. Which is a very important statement, I believe. And then, it was on 31st of December, which is quite interesting, what Bhagwan said. A simple experience I should tell you. Bhagwan was speaking about so many details. Suddenly he called an elderly person and said, look here, there is one driver. He had an attack of chicken pox. He is very thin and weak. Please tell there in the canteen, they should supply to the whole of his family breakfast, lunch, tea and dinner until that man recovers totally. Really, my eyes are filled with tears. The concern and the love he has, irrespective of cadre, irrespective of position, love showered on a driver. God knows no class and no caste. Yesterday, the 1st of January, 2003, you must have seen the old students of Sri Sathya Sai University, about 500 of them assembling and who presented a music program also last evening. Students who passed out of the portals of this institution in the year 1969 also were present yesterday. 1969, you can imagine what it is. And Swami was so happy. And my observation is, some of them look much older than Bhagwan Baba himself. Some of them are out of shape, the fat and all that. Some are even bald. But Baba looks ever young, ever green hero. I was just watching Swami and his old boys. That's the reason why they call old boys, boys who have become old perhaps. Somehow I am allergic to this word old boys. How can boys be old? And so I often say, former students or alumni, old boys, no one is old for that matter, all are young. Life is young, life is youthful, there is nothing like old age, no. The old age is related to the mind. So, I was so happy to watch all those boys and who assembled there. And you must have also heard two speakers. One, the secretary of the Central Trust, speaking on the drinking water supply project extended to Chennai, once upon a time called Madras, the capital of the state Tamil Nadu. I want to share with you some of the details because they have been discussed this afternoon also, the 2nd January 2003. The latest information I am conveying to you. Just imagine the pipeline laid for about 170 kilometers. 170 kilometers. And the deep pits, or I should say, or huge canals, are dug out. Size being 40 into 40. 40 in width, 40 feet. 40 feet in height. Across that huge canals, the pipes run. And there is one place by name Kandaleru, I believe. Kandaleru. K-A-N-D-E-L-U-R-U. Kandaleru. A place in Andhra Pradesh, belonging to Nellur district. A huge reservoir is constructed at a height of 85 feet. 85 feet. Taller than Hanuman here. Taller than Hanuman. And 45 lorries, loads of cement are used every day, per day. And some equipment is specially brought from foreign countries and mixers, you know, as they lay the roof, they mix cement and sand and gravel, you know, mixers. A mixer that could take 25 bags of cement at a stretch. At a stretch. In addition to sand and gravel, and huge machinery to collect all the gravel and the cement sand, and this mixer itself will start moving to different places collecting all that. When this is narrated, I could not believe what all that is happening there. A very massive program. Thousands of workers are involved in this program. And the work is taken up by an international organization, Larsen and Schuberow, L and T Company. You must have heard about it. It's an international organization. Do you know what they said? We have not taken up such a project till now. By working here, we learn now. We gain experience and we are learning many things. And then, a very popular newspaper from Tamil Nadu published on 29th of December full page photographs of the water project, two full pages concerning the details of the water project and Bhagavan's compassion towards humanity. The highlights are, no government can ever undertake such a project other than Bhagavan Sri Sat Sai Baba. Point one. Two, a project which is absolutely non-political, with no expectation, with no expectation, with no conditions, with no strings attached to that, the only selfless project undertaken by Bhagavan Sri Sat Sai Baba is unique in our times. That's what the newspaper said. Third point, Sri Sat Sai Baba staying in Puttaparthi, Prashantinilayam, far off from Chennai, supplying water to those people is unimaginable. Chennai people who have been suffering for want of drinking water, though many projects have been unsuccessfully undertaken by the government, it is Bhagavan Sri Sat Sai Baba who is going to supply drinking water to all the citizens of the city of Madras. Next point. This Sat Sai Baba drinking water project caters to both the requirements for irrigation purpose and also supply of drinking water. These are the statements mentioned there in the daily newspaper, and all these things were read out to us yesterday. You too must have come to know of that. Then, few points I should also make a mention to you. A committee of experts and vice chancellors, constituted specially by the University Grants Commission, Government of India, happened to visit Sri Sat Sai University in Prashantinilayam. That committee is very popularly called NAAC committee, N-A-A-C, NAAC. It's not ordinary NAAC of the world. This NAAC is different. National Assessment and Accreditation Council. National Assessment and Accreditation Council, specially constituted by UGC. This committee is supposed to go around the whole of the country, visit every department of the university, grade them, rank them at the national level, rank every department, grade every teacher's qualification, performance and research. If their conditions are not satisfied, professors, readers will not be promoted. The university will be ranked low. They have got certain parameters. And this NAAC committee went around the whole of this country. And the chairman of this committee usually monitors all this activity from Delhi. But he came to Puttaparthi along with other members, who happened to be the vice chancellors and professors, top experts, national and internationally reputed people. They visited the university. They had an audience with the professors, vice chancellors. They visited hostels. They went to Bangalore. They went to Anantapur. And what did they say? They all said unanimously that Sri Satya University is the crest jewel of universities of India. Point two, Sri Satya University is the best university, a model university for other universities to emulate, follow and learn. Point three, at a time the whole world is concerned to introduce values in the educational program which has not been totally successful anywhere till now. It is only in Sri Satya University where values have been integrated with the regular curriculum and academics. And further, they also recommended that Sri Satya University should start National Academic Staff College for Integral Education. It is not an easy thing. It is the achievement of avatar of our times. We take no credit. The appointments, the syllabus, the assessment, the equipment, everything is guided by Bhagavan all these years. God is perfection. Creator is perfection. Creation is perfection. And the university of God has got to be perfect. Is bound to be perfect. Nothing less than that. That's what about this news of jubilation. Good news to all Sai devotees the world over. Further, I should also tell you three points which I forgot to mention with regard to Abdul Kalam, the President of India. The President of India, he sent his salary, 2 months of his salary after taking over as the President of this country to Bhagavan as his contribution. President sending his salary with a note, with a letter of prayer, kindly accept Bhagavan. I am a bachelor. I am a bachelor. I don't need this money. I don't want it. Please kindly accept. That was his letter. And look at our Bhagavan. He did not take it, and he did not remit to any account, central trust account. He did not do that. He gave instructions immediately that a gold medal be specially instituted in the name of Abdul Kalam, the President of India, and gold medal be given every year on the interest accrued over the 2 lakhs deposited in the bank. And Satya Sai University is the only university in this country that has 2 gold medals instituted in the name of 2 past presidents of this country. We have a gold medal in the name of Dr. Shankar Dayal Sharma, the past president of this country, and we are going to have another gold medal instituted in the name of Dr. Abdul Kalam, the President of India. This is all Bhagavan's will. Further, Kalam also made a mention in his letter to Swami. Swami, it is only in place where I experienced supreme peace. And he wrote a letter to the Vice Chancellor and to Bhagavan also. When I happen to come there, do not place any special chair for me. I want to squat on the ground along with other devotees. I come there in the capacity of a devotee. That's what he said. You must have also noticed on that historic day of convocation of Sri Satsai University, the 23rd of November, the President of India at 9 o'clock came out of the guest house here, started going everywhere, the North Indian buildings, the sheds, auditorium. The security staff had hell of time. He said, you go, let me go, let me go. He went on moving everywhere, and every fellow could say Sai Ram to him. And he started responding, Sai Ram to everybody. Whereas the only place, the only president who got himself accessible to an average Indian, because all are one, my dear son, be alike to everyone. Translated in reality, in action, at the divine lotus feet of Bhagwan Sri Satya Sai Baba, this place being the sanctum, sanctorum of the avatar of our times. May Bhagwan bless you. Thank you very much.
Giridhar Gopal Murali Dhara Giridhar Govinda Gopal Damodara Giridhar Gopal Murali Dhara Giridhar Giridhar Gopal Murali Dhara Govinda Gopal Damodara Govinda Gopal Damodara Giridhar Gopal Murali Dhara Giridhar Gopal Murali Dhara Govinda Gopal Damodara Hari Govinda Gopal Damodara Giridhar Gopal Murali Dhara Giridhar Gopal Murali Dhara Govinda Gopal Damodara Govinda Gopal Damodara Giridhar Gopal Murali Dhara Govinda Gopal Damodara.
May Bhagavan shower his choicest blessings on everybody on the eve of the new year, 1st of January, year 2003. Sai bless you. Sai Ram.